Hello everyone, myself Babita. I'm working as an assistant professor in the Department of Electronics and Communication Engineering, Institute of Aeronautical Engineering, Dundigal. Today my topic is about PN junction diode and its voltage current characteristics. So these are the contents I'm going to discuss now. That is analog signal, what is meant by analog signal, and electron, what is mean by electron, and electronics, and what is mean by analog electronics, and what are the prerequisites required to understand the analog electronics subject. In that, I am going to discuss what are the sources which are required in the subject. Those are AC-DC sources and electrical components, and about semiconductor materials. So why we are discussing about this analog signal, electron, and electronics means in order to understand the what is mean by analog electronics. So here, what is mean by analog signal? Analog signal is nothing but continuously varying signal with respect to time. Continuously varying signal with respect to time indicates the analog signal. So these analog signals are available in two forms. Those are sinusoidal signals and non-sinusoidal signals. In the case of sinusoidal signals, we are having sinusoidal waveform as well as cosinusoidal waveform. In the case of non-sinusoidal signals, we are having square wave, pulse wave, as well as a triangular wave. So here, in order to represent the analog signal, I am considering sinusoidal signal. So this is the sinusoidal signal we are representing here with respect to time period T. Okay, so this analog signal we can define by using its amplitude and phase and its frequency or time period. So amplitude indicates the height of the signal. Amplitude indicates the height of the signal in both positive as well as in the negative direction. And frequency indicates the rate of the signal, at what rate the signal is varying. And phase angle represents the position of the signal, at what position the signal is varying with respect to time. So these are the characteristics of analog signal. So what are the major characteristics of analog signal here? So these are the time varying signals, that is nothing but the amplitude is varying with respect to time here. And the minimum and maximum values may be positive or negative here. Suppose I am taking my sinusoidal signal here. I am representing here it as plus V and here it is minus V. So this indicates the positive peak or positive amplitude will indicate here it as plus Vm, and the negative peak or negative amplitude is indicated here it as minus Vm. Okay, so if you want to represent peak to peak voltage, we will represent here it as V peak to peak, that is nothing but plus or minus Vm here. That is nothing but plus V is nothing but you can take some 2 volts for example, and minus V is nothing but you can take minus 2 volts. Okay, that is nothing but in this case plus or minus Vm is replaced with plus or minus 2 volts. That is nothing but in the positive peak plus 2 volts, in the negative peak minus 2 volts. That indicates the peak to peak value of any signal. Okay, these analog signals are available in the periodic form as well as in the non-periodic form. So what is mean by periodic form and not what is mean by non-periodic form? Periodic form means if you take one particular waveform, it repeats its pattern after one particular time period. Okay, it repeats its pattern after some particular time period. That is nothing but if I consider my signal as x of t. Okay, after some time period, that is x of t plus t. So it will repeat that same pattern. So then it belongs to the periodic signal. So while coming to the non-periodic signal, that signal should not repeat its pattern after some time period. So in this case, we can represent x of t equal to x of t naught equal to x of t plus t. So these indicates the periodic and non-periodic function of the signals. So analog signals are available in both the periodic form as well as in the non-periodic form. So these analog signals works on the continuous type of data, that is nothing but continuously varying with time. So the accuracy of this analog signals are not much high. Okay, these signals are used to measure some physical values or some natural values here. So these are the some specific characteristics of analog signals. These are applicable for any kind of analog signal. So what is the basic use of analog signal here? So if you want to design any particular electronic device, and after designing that particular device, in order to check the performance of that particular device, we need to apply some particular input and we need to verify the corresponding output whether we are getting perfect or not. So in order to check that this particular analog signal, we are using here it as the input for the electronic device to see the output or performance of that particular design device. And what is the basic disadvantage of this analog signals? So in the while coming to the disadvantages, analog signals are not resistant towards the noise. That is nothing but because of that noise, distortion exists in the transmission line, so that the transmission quality of the output will be changes or reduces here because of the disadvantage of this analog signal. So here we cannot fix the value of this analog signal. We cannot fix the range of that particular analog signal. So while coming to the examples of this analog signal, this can be a human voice or video signal or radio transmission wave or TV transmission wave. These all are the best examples of the analog signal, and these all are continuously varying with respect to time. And after understanding the analog signal, we require the knowledge about electron here in order to understand what is meant by analog electronics. Okay, to understand about electron, I am considering the atom here. This is the structure of the atom. So in the atom, we are having protons, electrons as well as neutrons. So while coming to the electron, which is available on the outer shell of the or outer orbit of the atom, it will surrounding on the outer orbit of the atom. Okay, each and every electron carries one unit of negative charge, that is 1.602 × 10⁻¹⁹ coulombs. That is the charge of electron. And while coming to the weight of the electron, so the mass of the electron is very less compared to the electron and proton. So the mass of an electron is 9.103 × 10⁻³⁹ kilograms. So this is the mass of an electron. And charge of an electron is 1.602 × 10⁻¹⁹ coulomb. So the symbol for electron, we will represent it as E subscript minus. So what is mean by electronics? So next we will discuss about electronics. So electronics is nothing but it is the study of flow of the electrons, that is nothing but how to control the flow of electrons will indicates the electronics here. Okay, and we can also define electronics is the field of science and engineering which deals with the flow of electrons through a vacuum or a gas or a semiconductor material. So in the olden days, to design the electronic devices, we used the vacuum tubes, later on gases. Now we are using the semiconductor materials. So why they changed from vacuum tubes to semiconductor materials means, if you take the vacuum tube, we can observe this vacuum tube on the olden computers. Backside of the olden computer, we can observe the vacuum tube. It is a long tube with empty space. So the size of the vacuum tube is very high. So the power consumption of the vacuum tube is also very high, and it is costly. And if you design the any electronic device by using vacuum tube, the size of the device is also bulky and it is high. in order to overcome these disadvantages, we are changing from vacuum tube to semiconductor materials. So in the case of semiconductor materials, we can take any small part or any tiny piece of semiconductor material and we can design any device by using that particular material. So the size of the semiconductor material is very less. The power consumption of the semiconductor material also very less. Okay. And the cost of the semiconductor material also very less. And once you design any device by using the semiconductor material, the cost of the device is also very less and speed of the device is also very high. So in order to get these advantages, we are using semiconductor material to design any electronic device instead of vacuum tubes. So, and one more advantage here it is, if you design any device using semiconductor material, so the size of the device is very small, so that so many hundreds and thousands of devices we can integrate on the small single chip. So that is the main advantage of the using semiconductor material in the designing of electronic devices. So here the devices in which the conduction is due to the flow of electrons are called electronic devices. So what is mean by analog electronics? So till now we discussed what is mean by analog signal, what are the characteristics of that analog signals, and then what is electron and what is mean by electronics. So in order to interrelate that analog signal with this electronics, we are talking about analog electronics here. So these analog electronics are electronic systems with a continuously variable signal. That is nothing but for a particular electronic device, we are giving the input as analog signal and we are checking the performance of that particular device. Okay, those are indicates the analog electronic devices. And in order to understand the analog electronics, what are the prerequisites required? Here it is, first thing is AC or DC sources. Okay, what is mean by AC DC sources and what is mean by AC DC currents? So AC voltage, here it is nothing but alternating current voltage. DC voltage is nothing but direct current voltage. So AC voltage represents in the positive direction as well as in the negative direction, and the DC voltage will indicate the constant or in the positive direction only. That may be in the case of voltage as well as in the case of current. So how to represent this AC DC sources, we will see now. So this symbol indicates the battery here. This is the DC battery or DC voltage, and this indicates the battery with polarities, that is nothing but plus with positive polarity and minus with negative polarity. And this one represents the ideal current source with circuit with horizontal line, and this represents the ideal voltage source with a vertical line, and this represents the AC current source in the circuit, we will represent with sinusoidal signal and also downward arrow. This indicates the AC current source. And next, AC voltage source is nothing but circle with sinusoidal waveform. And DC current source means circle with positive and negative symbols. And DC voltage source is also circle with positive and negative terminals. So these all are the representations of AC voltage and current as well as DC voltage and current. So how we can generate this particular analog signal or analog source means by using oscillator device. By using the oscillator, we can able to generate the sinusoidal waveform that we can use as input for your electronic devices. And what is the next prerequisites means electrical components. We have to know some knowledge on electrical components in order to understand the concepts in analog electronics. So first one is resistor. So resistor is nothing but electrical component and it is a passive device and it is having two terminals here. So what is the basic function of the resistor here means it is used to oppose the flow of current in the device and it is used to control the current conduction in the device, you can see. And according to Ohm's law, we can represent the resistance R equal to voltage divided by current. So the symbol for resistor is like this, and this is the resistor component we can observe in the lab. So each and every resistor is having some bands with some colors. So by using this color bands, we can able to find the value of resistance of particular resistor. And the units for resistor is ohms here. So in electronic circuits, these resistors are used to reduce the current flow and adjust the signal levels and also terminate the transmission lines. So these are the basic applications of the resistor. So next electrical component is capacitor. So this capacitor is the device which stores the electrical energy in electrical field. So it is also having two terminals. Okay. So if you take any particular capacitor, it is having two parallel plates that stores the electrons, and the gap between the two plates, we can call it as the dielectric material or insulator, which opposes the flow of electrons or charge carriers. So we can represent the capacitor like this, and this is the capacitor which is available in the lab for experiments, and the capacitance we can measure in farads. And next electrical component is inductor. So inductor which stores the energy in magnetic field. Okay, so this is the symbol for inductor, and this is the representation of the inductor here. So the inductance we will measure in Henry's. So the units for inductance is Henry's. And next prerequisites for analog electron is semiconductor material. Why we are discussing about semiconductor material means, I have already mentioned, in order to design any electronic component or electronic device, now we are using semiconductor material instead of vacuum tubes. So before going to the semiconductor material, first of all, we have to know what is mean by material. So material is nothing but it is a substance which is used to make one particular object, which is used to make some physical object. So these materials are of two types. One is crystalline type of materials, and second one is non-crystalline type of materials. So while coming to the crystalline type of materials, these are having some shape. While coming to the non-crystalline type of materials, it doesn't have any shape. So that's why we are going to use the crystalline materials instead of non-crystalline materials to design the devices. So these crystalline materials are again divided into three types. Those are conductors, insulators, and semiconductors. So if we take one particular material, how we can differentiate that material belongs to the insulator or semiconductor or conductor means, by using its energy band structure, we can able to differentiate the given material. So these are the energy band structures of the materials. So first energy band structure indicates the insulator energy band structure. So here first we are having the conduction band. Conduction band is nothing but it consists of vacant states, and they are ready to accept the electrons from the valence band. In the valence band, we are having vacant states, valence electrons. So those are ready to move to the conduction band. So the gap between this conduction band as well as valence band indicates the band gap or forbidden gap. We can measure the forbidden gap in electron ohms. So depends upon the gap between this valence band and conduction band, we can able to differentiate the materials here. So in the case of insulator, the band gap between the conduction band and valence band is very high. That is almost 9 electron volts. In the case of insulator, the energy gap is 9 electron volts. So 9 electron volts means the energy gap between the conduction band and valence band is very high. So there is no chance of movement of electrons from the conduction band to the valence band. So that's why in the case of insulators, the conductivity is very less. So, well, coming to the semiconductors. This is the energy band structure of the semiconductor material, and this is the energy band structure of the conductor. So, well, coming to the insulator, we have already mentioned the band gap is very high, so that the conductivity is very, very less. So, once the conductivity is very less, means the current is very less in the insulator, so that the resistivity of the material is very high. Why? Because resistor and current are inversely proportional. So, the resistivity of the insulator is 10 power 10 to 10 power 12 ohm centimeter. This is the range of resistivity in the case of insulator. So, what are the examples of this insulator? Here means paper, mica, glass and quartz. These are the examples of insulator material. And next kind of material is the conductor. So, in the case of conductor, if you observe the energy band structure, the gap between the conduction band and valence band is 0 electron volts. There is no energy gap between the conduction band and valence band. So, that is nothing but more number of charge carriers are present in the material, so that the conductivity is very high. That is nothing but current conduction in the conductor is very high, so that the resistivity is very less. So, the resistivity is almost 10 power minus 4 to 10 power minus 6 ohm centimeters in the case of conductors. Okay, so the best examples for the conductor are copper, aluminium, gold, silver. So, these are the examples of the conductor. So, next material is the semiconductor material. So, if you observe the energy band structure of semiconductor material, the band gap between the valence band as well as the conduction band is 2 electron volts here. So, if we compare the band gap of all the three materials, the band gap of semiconductor material is not more than the insulator but not less than the conductor. So, the energy gap is in between conductor and insulator in the case of semiconductor, so that the conductivity or the flow of charge carriers are also medium or moderate in the case of semiconductor material. So, the resistivity is 10 power 4 ohm centimeters in the case of semiconductor. So, the examples for semiconductor material is silicon and germanium. And so, here in order to design any electronic device, we are going to use the semiconductor material only. So, we are having two semiconductor materials, germanium and silicon. So, the energy gap of germanium material is 0.6 electron volts and the energy gap for silicon material is 1.1 electron volts. So, here 1 electron volt is equivalent to 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 joules. 1 electron volt equal to 1.6 into 10 power minus 19 joules. See, these are the atomic structures of semiconductor material, both the silicon and germanium. So, both silicon and germanium are having 4 valence electrons in their outer shell of the atom. 4 valence electrons are present on the outer shells of the silicon and germanium materials. So, now we will see the different types of semiconductor materials. Semiconductor materials are available in two types. Those are intrinsic semiconductor and extrinsic semiconductor. Intrinsic semiconductors are nothing but pure form of germanium or silicon materials. So, in this case, the number of charge carriers are equal to the number of intrinsic levels in the case of pure semiconductor. So, in the case of extrinsic semiconductor, we are having again two types. N-type of semiconductor and P-type of semiconductor materials. So, in the case of N-type of material, electrons are more compared to the holes. In the case of P-type of materials, holes are more compared to the electrons. But in the case of pure intrinsic semiconductor, both the electrons and holes are equal. So, while coming to the intrinsic semiconductor, it is a pure form of semiconductor material. So, in the case of semiconductor, conduction is due to either thermal excitation or due to the crystal defects. To understand this, I have considered the crystal lattice of silicon semiconductor material here. So each and every silicon atom is having 4 valence electrons on the outer orbit. So each and every silicon atom form a covalent band with the nearby silicon atom here. Okay, and after that we can get some valence electron. So this is the crystal lattice of silicon material. So how the conduction will appear in the case of intrinsic semiconductor? In order to understand that, I have considered cross section of germanium crystal here. Okay, cross section of germanium crystal here. So each and every germanium atom is having 4 valence electrons. Okay, and this middle part indicates the nucleus of germanium atom. So how the charge carriers are moving here, we will see. So in the first, the electron from this particular atom move to left side and combine with the hole here. So once this electron moved here means it creates one hole here. So this particular hole filled with beside one more electron, that electron comes and combine with this hole and it creates one more hole. So in this way, the movement of charge carriers will occur in the case of intrinsic semiconductor. But in the case of intrinsic semiconductor, the conductivity is somewhat less. Why? Because we are getting equal number of charge carriers. Electrons and holes are equal in the case of intrinsic semiconductor. So in order to increase the conductivity level of intrinsic semiconductor, we are moving with the extrinsic semiconductor. So how we can form the extrinsic semiconductor? If we add some impurities to the intrinsic semiconductor, it becomes the extrinsic semiconductor. So the process of adding impurities to the intrinsic semiconductor is called the doping. So now we will see how we can form the extrinsic semiconductors. These extrinsic semiconductors are again available in 2 forms, N-type of semiconductor material as well as P-type of semiconductor material. So now let us see how we can make the N-type of semiconductor material. So for that purpose, I am considering the silicon material as a intrinsic semiconductor material. I am considering the phosphorus material here. So if we add, for the silicon material, if we add pentavalent impurities, then we can form the N-type of semiconductors. So what are that pentavalent impurities? Arsenic, antimony, phosphorus are the pentavalent impurities. So if we add these particular impurities to the silicon material, then it becomes the N-type of semiconductor material. So to understand that, I'm considering the crystal lattice structure of silicon doped with phosphorus. So here, silicon is having 4 valence electrons in the outer shell. But if you take the phosphorus, phosphorus is having 5 valence electrons in the outer shell. So each and every valence electron of silicon is forming covalent band with the each and every valence electron of the phosphorus. So 4 valence electrons of silicon forming the covalent band with the 4 valence electrons of the phosphorus. But one more electron is there extra here for conduction. One more extra electron is there for conduction in the case of phosphorus. So because of this adding pentavalent phosphorus impurities to the silicon material, more number of electrons are creating in the semiconductor material. So electron means it is having negative charge. So that's why it is named as N-type of semiconductor material. So in the case of N-type of semiconductor material, electrons are the majority carriers, holes are the minority carriers. So in the case of intrinsic semiconductor, electrons and holes are equal. But in the case of N-type of extrinsic semiconductor, electrons are the majority carriers, holes are the minority carriers. So next we will see how we can form the P type of semiconductor material. So if we add for any pure intrinsic semiconductor any trivalent impurities, then we can get the P type of semiconductor material. So here I am considering a intrinsic semiconductor as silicon, and trivalent impurities are here boron, gallium, indium. We can take anyone. Here I am considering boron as my trivalent impurity. So in order to understand this, I am considering the crystal lattice structure of silicon doped with boron. So here each and every silicon atom is having 4 valence electrons, and each and every boron atom is having 3 valence electrons. So the 3 valence electrons of boron is forming covalent band with the valence electrons of the silicon. But one hole is there that is ready to accept the electron. So because of this adding trivalent impurities, more number of holes are generating in the semiconductor material. So hole is having positive charge. So that's why it is called as P type of semiconductor material. So in the case of P type of semiconductor material, holes are the majority carriers, electrons are the minority carriers. Okay, till now we discussed what are the prerequisites required in order to understand the analog electronic subject. And next I am moving to the PN junction diode. So before moving to the PN junction diode, first of all we have to know what is mean by diode. So if any device is formed by joining one piece of P type of semiconductor material and one piece of N type of semiconductor material, if you join the two materials, one device is formed, that is called as PN junction diode. So here I am considering one piece of P type of semiconductor material. So in the case of P type of material, holes are the majority carriers, so many number of holes will present. So hole we can represent here it as either circle or with plus symbol. Okay, so in the P type of material, majority carriers are holes, so that's why I'm representing more holes and less number of electrons. And electron we can represent here it as with either dot or negative symbol. So next I am taking the N type of semiconductor material. So in the case of N type of semiconductor material, electrons are the majority carriers, holes are the minority carriers. So in the case of PN junction diode, we are going to discuss 3 things here. How to form the depletion region in the case of PN junction diode, and how it is operating in the forward bias as well as in the reverse bias condition, and what are the characteristics of the diode. So in the first case, we are taking the how to form the depletion region in the case of PN junction diode. For that, I am considering one P type of semiconductor material, and I am joining this P type of semiconductor material with the N type of semiconductor material. Holes I am representing here with the plus symbol and electrons with the minus symbol. In the case of N type material also, electrons with the minus and holes with the plus. So as soon as when we join this P type of semiconductor material as well as N type of semiconductor material, the majority carriers which are present in the material are trying to diffuse or move towards the opposite direction. That is nothing but the holes which are present in the P type of material are trying to move towards the N type of semiconductor material. And the electrons which are present in the N type of semiconductor material are trying to diffuse towards the P type of semiconductor material. So because of this diffusion process, the depletion region is forming across the junction. How? We will see now. So if one particular electron is moving from n-type material to p-type material, so once this electron is leaving this particular place and moving to the p-type material, means it creates one hole here. When electron is moving from n-type material to p-type material, means it creates one hole there. And once this electron is combining the hole which is present in the p-type material, that hole loses its charge and it becomes the negative immobile ion. So because of this diffusion process, so many number of positive immobile ions are available in the n-type of material across the junction, and so many number of negative immobile charge carriers are available in the p-type of semiconductor material across the junction. Okay, so electron is leaving this space, means it loses its negative charge and it becomes the positive immobile ion. So once the hole accepting that particular electron, means it loses its positive charge and it becomes the negative immobile ion. So many number of positive as well as negative immobile ions are forming near the junction. So this region we are calling it as depletion region here. The positive and immobile, the positive and negative immobile charge carriers place we are representing here as depletion region. So in the case of depletion region, here also it creates some electric field. Okay, that one I am representing with the battery here, negative. Why? Because here we are having negative charge, and inside I am representing with the positive terminal. Why? Because here we are having positive charge carriers. So this potential we are calling it as barrier potential of the PN junction diode. So here these holes are the majority carriers, and electrons are the minority carriers in the case of p-type material. And here electrons are the majority carriers, and holes are the minority carriers in the case of n-type of material. So after forming these negative and positive immobile ions across the junction, now there is no movement of charge carriers from P to N and N to P here. Why? Because this depletion region acts like a barrier between both the materials here. So there is no movement of charge carriers here. So this depletion region total width I am representing here it as D. So how much it is extending towards the n-type I am representing with Dn, and how much it is extending in the p-type material I am representing it with Dp. So the total distance of depletion region is the sum of the distance in the p region and in the n region. Okay, and here it is having donor type of positive charge carriers, and these are the acceptor type of charge carriers. So across the depletion region, across at equilibrium state, ND, DN is equal to NA, DP. That is nothing but charge carrier concentration in the P side into its depletion region distance is equal to charge carrier concentration in the N side into depletion region width in the N region. So this is the equilibrium state. Once this equilibrium state occurs, means there is no movement of charge carriers from P to N material and N to P material. So this indicates the formation of the depletion region once you form the p-n junction diode. And we will add two terminals here. One is P-type, we are calling it as the anode terminal, and inside we are calling it as the cathode terminal. So this is the formation of the depletion region. So now we will see how the diode will operate. So here, once you are forming the PN junction diode, because of the movement of the charge carriers, there is a depletion region is formed. Okay, there is a depletion region formed. And at equilibrium state, equal number of charge carriers are present in the diode. So there is no movement of majority charge carriers, so that there is no current flow in the device. Okay, so in order to conduct the device, we have to provide the biasing for the device. So what is mean by biasing? If you apply the voltage in order to conduct any device, that indicates the biasing of the device. So these biasing is of two types, forward biasing and reverse biasing. So the diode will operate in both the forward bias condition as well as in the reverse bias condition. So first we will see the forward bias condition of the diode. So what is mean by forward bias here? So the positive terminal of the battery is connected to the P-type of material, and the negative terminal of the battery is connected to the cathode terminal of the P-N junction diode. Then we can say the diode is in the forward bias condition. So now what will happen once you connect the battery to the P-N junction diode? See, the majority carriers which are present in the P-type material are repelling with this positive terminal of the battery, and they are trying to move or diffuse towards the junction. And similarly, the majority carriers which are present in the N-type of material, those are electrons which are repelling with this negative terminal of the battery, and they are trying to diffuse or move towards the depletion region. So what will happen here? If we increase the voltage, the more number of charge carriers, the velocity of the charge carriers will increase, and they are trying to diffuse inside the depletion region. Okay, so the majority carriers holes will crosses the depletion region, and those will recombine with the negative immobile ions which are present near the junction. And similarly, the electrons which are the majority carriers are diffusing into the depletion region, and they are trying to recombine with the positive immobile ions which are present near the junction. So because of this recombination process, the depletion region width will be reduces. And if you still increase the voltage, at that particular voltage, the depletion region width totally, it will reduces and it becomes zero. So once the depletion region is disappears, means there is a large movement of charge carriers in the case of diodes. So there is a flow of current in the device or in the diode. So how much voltage we require here? Once you are forming the diode, we got the depletion region. So further depletion region is also having some voltage. That is called the barrier voltage. So this barrier voltage is 0.2 volts in the case of germanium diodes, and 0.6 volts in the case of silicon diode. Okay. So once the diode is operating the forward bias condition, you will get the graph like this. That is forward voltage versus forward current IF. So you will get much amount of current here, that is in milliamps. In the forward bias diode, we will get the current in milliamps, so that the resistance is very less. Almost we will get very few ohms in the case of forward biased PN junction diode. So once you apply the voltage, some 0.1, 0.2, 0.3 like this, and if you keep on increasing this, you will get the corresponding current, 1 milliamp, 2 milliamps, 3 milliamps, and so on. So I am giving my voltage, forward voltage to diode, and I am increasing slowly the voltage I am getting the corresponding variation in the current. But once it reaches the 0.3 ohms, there is a sudden rise of current in the diode. Why? Why means this 0.3 will indicates the cut-in voltage of the diode. So cut-in voltage means the diode where the current conduction is high. At that point, how much voltage is there? That indicates the cut-in voltage. So this cut-in voltage is 0.3 ohms for germanium diode and 0.7 ohms in the case of silicon diode. That is nothing but here I am considering the germanium diode. So once your applied voltage crosses the 0.3 ohms, there is a sudden rise of current here. And always the cut-in voltage should be greater than the barrier potential. That is nothing but your applied voltage should be greater than the barrier potential. Then only we can expect high current in the device and low resistance in the device. So this is the operation of the diode in the case of forward bias condition. So while coming to the reverse bias operation of the PN junction diode. So what is mean by reverse bias here? I am considering the PN diode again here and I am connecting the positive or P-type material with the negative terminal of the battery and the N-side or cathode terminal of the diode I am connecting with the positive terminal of the battery. So I am giving or I am providing the reverse voltage to your diode. And the N-type, we are having more electrons, less holes. So in the case of reverse bias condition, across the junction, we are having negative immobile ions as well as positive immobile ions. Okay. So once you apply the reverse voltage, the majority carriers which are present in the P-type of semiconductor material are coming towards the negative terminal of the battery. They are attracting towards the negative terminal of the battery. And similarly, the majority carriers which are present in the N-type of material, those are electrons, are also trying to coming away from the junction and they are attracting towards the positive terminal of the battery. So, because of the movement of charge carriers away from the junction, in the case of reverse bias diode, the depletion region width still more it will increase. Okay, the depletion region width will be increases still more in the case of reverse bias PN junction diode. So what will happen? The depletion region width is very high means there is no movement of charge carriers. So there is no movement of, there is no flow of current in the device, that is forward current. There is no forward current in the case of reverse bias operation of the diode. But the minority carriers which are present in the P-type of material are repelling with this negative terminal of the battery and they are trying to diffuse towards the N-type of material and they are trying to recombine with the positive immobile ions which are present near the junction. And because of this recombination process and movement of electrons, very little amount of reverse current or leakage current is flowing in the diode. So that current we can call it as reverse saturation current or leakage current. And it is very less. It is some microamperes in the case of germanium diode and nanoamperes in the case of silicon diode. And in this case, we will get the resistance is very high. Why? Because current is very less. And one more thing, always the current direction in any device is opposite to the electron flow. So in this case, electron flow is from here to here. So current direction is from here to here. So that's where reverse current is from N to P and it is negative value. But forward current is from P to N and this value is positive. In this, in the positive bias or in the forward bias, electron flow is from N to P. That's why current flow is from P to N. This is a very important point in the case of PN junction diode. Forward current always will flow from P to N, that is anode to cathode, and reverse current always will flow from N to P, that is cathode to anode. And we will get much resistance in the case of reverse bias condition. And if you represent the VI characteristics of this one, that is minus VR with respect to IR. So if you slowly increase the reverse voltage, you will get very little amount of reverse saturation current. But at one particular voltage level, we will get the high current, or there is a rapid change in the current. So that particular voltage, we are calling it as the breakdown voltage. So at the breakdown voltage, we will get the high reverse saturation current in the reverse bias condition. That particular voltage, we are calling it as the breakdown voltage of the diode. So now we will see the VI characteristics of the PN junction diode, both in the case of forward bias as well as in the case of reverse bias. So for that, I am considering the forward voltage VF in volts and the corresponding forward current in milliamperes. I am considering the germanium diode here. Okay. And I am taking the reverse voltage VR in volts and the reverse current IR in microamperes. So in the forward bias condition, once you apply the voltage slowly, so the current is also increasing slowly. But once it reaches the cut-in voltage, there is a sudden rise of current. So that indicates the cut-in voltage or knee voltage of the diode. That is 0.3 volts in the case of germanium diode, and the barrier potential is 0.2 volts in the case of germanium diode. And always, once the applied voltage crosses the barrier potential only, there is a large conductivity in the device. And similarly, in the case of reverse bias condition, also if you slowly increase the reverse voltage, very little amount of reverse saturation current will appear. But at one particular voltage, there is a rapid increase in the reverse current. So that particular voltage, we are calling it as the breakdown voltage. Okay. In the case of PN junction diode, we should not increase the reverse voltage much. So once the reverse voltage increases, means there is a large flow of reverse current that will damage the device, that will break the junction. So mostly PN junction diode will operate in the forward bias condition only. That's why it is called as unidirectional device. PN junction diode is called as unidirectional device. So because of that reason only, we are representing the symbol of PN junction diode with forward arrow. That indicates the current direction in the forward bias condition, that is from anode to cathode. And always we will use in the forward bias condition only for any applications. So while coming to the applications of the PN junction diode, we are having the rectifiers, clippers and clampers. These are the major applications of the PN junction diode. Thank you all.
Like, share and subscribe. Hit the bell icon for more updates.